Phil Hader is one of the best things to ever come out of the sketch comedy show Saturday Night Live. After 8 years of sketches, he's now making his mark on the big screen with breakout roles in movies like Superbad, the award-winning Skeleton Twins, Inside Out, and now he is playing a romantic lead for the very first time in the new movie Trainwreck.
Do you like me?
Yeah.
Yeah, see, I really like you. So we should be a couple.
So, it's nice to see you as a romantic lead.
Oh, thank
you. It
feels
like it's overdue.
Oh, you're very sweet. Thank
you. What are you going to do in a Nicholas Sparks movie?
I know. I thought this was a Nicholas Sparks movie, and then I found out, it's like, Amy Schumer's doing a Nicholas Sparks movie? Oh, that's weird.
I think there's a thing that not a lot of people know about you, which is that initially when you went out to Hollywood, it wasn't necessarily to do comedy. What was the original kind of plan?
The original plan was to move to Los Angeles and be a filmmaker. And then what happened was I spent, and this happens a lot, you spend 6 years in LA just trying to pay the bills.
I was working as an assistant editor on Iron Chef America, doing a comedy show in a backyard in Los Angeles.
And you just don't have time to be creative. You don't have time to do your own thing because you have no money. You know, it's just
broke. You mean your time working on the Playboy Channel wasn't creative?
Yeah, it wasn't creative at all. It was the only creative thing about Night Calls.
Night Calls!
It was a phone sex talk show and people would call in live. It was my first live TV experience, and it was people calling in live with fantasies. It was hosted by two porn stars.
Naturally.
And then my job was to sit with this kind of, you know, it was about a dozen porn stars off to the right, and they would say, all right, Bill, get Cynthia and Candy ready. And I'd be like, Cynthia, Candy, you guys want to get up? It's like, so you're a cowboy? And you're a, you know.
They just had like all the costumes ready.
They just had the costumes, like, you guys go out and do your thing. And then you would sit there. And all my friends and my roommates were like, that must be really awesome. And I was like, no, it's the saddest thing on earth. I felt so embarrassed the whole time.
So with that being your first live TV experience, was there any usable lesson from that that you could port over to SNL?
No, nothing.
Now I would like to take a moment to introduce our two new feature players, Bill Hader and Andy Samberg.
When you did it land on SNL, you were really nervous. Like, it was like a good like 5 seasons before you kind of felt comfortable.
Yeah, no, it's true.
Why so long?
It was really rough. It was because you're always on shaky ground there. You know, each week you just want to get on air and prove yourself. And but I'm not by nature a very competitive person, you know. And I actually shy away from when I feel like people are being competitive. It's like they're throwing a ball at me and I never catch it and throw it back. I just kind of like let it bounce off my chest and let it roll over there. I'm like, what are you doing? Don't do that. And then I walk off.
The competition's like the DNA of SNL.
Yeah, well, that's what Seth Meyers and Amy Poehler taught me was, yes, you're right, the DNA of SNL is competitiveness, but we don't have to be competitive with each other. We are an ensemble.
Please welcome Mindy Elise Grayson.
And that's what I always tell people when they're new, is like, your whole job on that show is bringing two funny things to the table every Wednesday and committing to every sketch that you're in, you know? That's all you can do. Everything else is out of your control.
Tell us, Dr. Jekyll, what do you do when you become this Mr. Hyde?
I'm attracted to women, like my wife. It's Mr. Hyde who does stuff with guys.
And it was a great lesson of how just, you know, show business works, that it's all like this, you know? It's just, it's never that, you know? It's always this kind of, for no reason why certain things work and don't work and what, you know, or whatever it is. And what I was so happy with was that everyone was kind of like doing that, but we all stayed friends. But that took 4 years to kind of understand that. Yeah. It took me 4 seasons to understand, like, oh, we're all good with each other. I remember the first time I did Vinny Vedecci, the Italian talk show host.
Vinny Vedecci!
I did it at the table read, and afterwards everyone applauded. And I went, oh, because they knew I needed that.
Un santa ragando, noche, caraserevando, etaraserevando, italiano, bis reverende, shia lebof.
They knew, like, I had been going for 7, 8 shows with nothing. And I felt like, oh, I belong here. This is good.
But not everyone on SNL had such an august comedic streak in their family. I understand your dad did stand-up at one point.
Yeah, my dad did do stand-up a little bit, growing up. I never saw his act. He would tell me later about his act. But he stopped because it was me and my two sisters, and we were really young, and my mom was like, go back to being a truck driver. And he went back to being a truck driver.
Does that give you an indication of how good he actually was?
I don't know. He's hilarious. And I think the thing that my dad helped me with was that he introduced me to great comedy at a young age. Like Monty Python and Spinal Tap and early Woody Allen movies and things like that.
The stuff that you really take into your heart as a young comedy fan.
Yeah, like that. I was seeing that, you know, at age six. Like, that was comedy. Like, you had to find comedy. I would go, oh, Monty Python, the Holy Grail, that's comedy. It wasn't, you know, like a sitcom or something.
And it's not like now where everything exists on YouTube and everything's searchable. When you find stuff at that age, just like, this is mine. I feel this sense of ownership.
Yeah, and you feel like a real sense of ownership over it. That's totally true. Yeah, and I think that, I don't think I would be doing what I'm doing if he hadn't done that, you know.
Bill, you're great to talk to.
Thanks.
You're really, really lovely.
Oh, thank you, buddy.
Thank you.
Nice talking to you, man.